Ukraine is one of the world's major grain producers, but Russian warships have blockaded its ports and cut off vital shipments of grain to some of the world's most vulnerable populations. On Wednesday, the US pledged an additional $250 million in emergency food aid to deal with the grain crisis. The UN's top food official pleaded with Russia's leader to end the blockade.
It is absolutely essential that we allow these ports to open, because this is not just about Ukraine. This is about the poorest of the poor around the world who are on the brink of starvation as we speak. So I ask President Putin, if you have any heart at all, to please open these ports.
Russian actions to weaponize food go well beyond the blockade. In agricultural areas they currently control, the Russians are accused of stealing farm equipment and tons of grain from Ukrainian farmers. We'll get more now from CNN's Issa Soares.
Before the war, most of the food produced by Ukraine was exported through ports like this. Now, these key trading docks have ground to a halt, blockaded by Russia, who, according to Ukraine's defense ministry, has also pilfered an estimated 400,000 tons of grain from Ukrainian farmers in Russian-occupied territory. Footage obtained by CNN from Melitopol, Zaporizhia, shows trucks bearing the white Z symbol of the Russian military, transporting grain to Russian-held Crimea. An act that President Zelensky's administration is calling food terrorism.
This is not just a strike at Ukraine. Without our agrarian export, dozens of countries in various regions of the world have found themselves on the brink of food deficit.
Through satellite images, we were able to identify the Russian merchant ship Matros Poznik, one of three involved in the trade of stolen grain, seen here at the port in Sevastopol, Crimea, on April 29th. From there, the vessel carrying an estimated 27,000 tons of grain, according to maritime tracking site Fleetmon, traveled through the Bosphorus to Alexandria in Egypt, but was denied port. Then it went on to Beirut in Lebanon, but was also turned away. Finally, on May 8th, it reached Latakia, the principal port in Syria, according to shipping sources and Ukrainian officials.
So in this situation, the countries in the Middle East and in the Northern Africa, they don't have choice, okay? And they will import wheat from anywhere from where it's possible. So I think this is really state-supported theft of Ukrainian assets, of Ukrainian grain.
For Russia, stealing wheat and other grains during the war could prove lucrative. The price of wheat has skyrocketed so far this year, more than 60% or so, spiking after the war started on February 24th. And how much of a valuable commodity is it? Well, the price of wheat is now trading about $400 a ton on the world market. As supplies run low and as prices continue to rise, there are fears the war is pushing the world to the brink of a food crisis, with the German foreign minister calling Russia's actions a deliberate war of grains. After seeing for himself the tons of grain, wheat and corn stockpiled in Odessa, the president of the European Council, Charles Michel, vowed the EU, with support from the US, will help look for ways to export grain from Ukraine. Some of it is already being shipped from ports in neighboring Romania, but still only a fraction of Ukraine's total production. More help is needed if Europe's breadbasket is to continue to feed the world. Issa Soares, CNN.
Let's take you live to Brussels. EU lawmakers are debating how to keep energy supplies flowing as tensions grow with Russia. Moscow has already shut off its gas exports to Poland and Bulgaria. There are signs Finland could be next, possibly as soon as this weekend. For more, I'm joined by Claire Sebastian. It's not as clear-cut as the Kremlin saying we're cutting off supplies, but that's how it's being interpreted.
Well, and of course, we have precedent, right, with Poland and Bulgaria, and now the Finnish gas company Gasum is saying that they are not going to use this payment mechanism that Moscow has set up, where you sort of have to deposit euros, then they get converted to rubles. They're not going to do that, so they say it's now likely they think that the gas will be shut off this weekend. And this is why, Max, that the EU is no longer treating this as a hypothetical, obviously. It's been done before. They know it could happen. They just launched their new $221 billion plan to essentially redraw the energy map of Europe, to try to eventually do without Russian energy. No real surprises there. More LNG, more renewables, cutting demand, that's critical. They say they can do that by about 5%, just simple things like turning the lights off, using less air conditioning. And they have sort of put together a plan for what they would do for a sudden stop when it comes to Russian gas. And that would involve sort of working together, pooling their resources and shifting energy from the places that need it less to the more critical need.
The other thing the Russians control, which is vital to the world economy, is Ukrainian grain. They're effectively... It's effectively trapped, isn't it, in these Ukrainian ports. And ISA, they're describing how this is now being described as a grain war.
I mean, you know, it's a horrifying situation. You heard the head of the World Food Programme saying that people are on the brink of starvation because of this.
These are parts of Africa, largely, aren't they, that rely on those supplies?
Yeah, countries like Somalia, for example, get 100% of their wheat from, or did at least before this conflict, from Russia and Ukraine. It is affecting the poorest of the poor. And it's interesting because the rhetoric in Russia around this is... This is the result of sanctions. The sanctioners are the aggressors here. You have them to blame for rising inflation in Europe, for these food shortages. But we heard from Antony Blinken, the US Secretary of State, yesterday, trying to counter that argument. Take a listen.
Some have tried to blame the sanctions imposed on the Russian Federation by the United States and many other countries for worsening this crisis. This is false. When we impose sanctions on Russia, in order to end the war as quickly as possible, we deliberately and carefully created exceptions for agricultural goods and fertilizer. We're working every day to get countries any information or assistance they need.
You know, Max, the sanctions landscape is complicated. There's been self-sanctioning. There's been uncertainty that has sort of upended trade in many ways. You know, shipping companies, banks have been reluctant to sort of get grain shipments out of countries like Russia and Ukraine because of this uncertainty. But the bottom line is there are no sanctions that would prevent Russia from reopening the ports on the Black Sea.
Okay, Claire, thank you.